Dogumentary TV, producing the best breed documentaries on YouTube.
I'm Marcus Curtis, Oral Mostinos, founder of the American Molossus. So since we talked about the American Molossus last, it was like 6 to a year out, well, they're here. Really pumped up, really excited, and I would say I dreamt it, so I kind of expected it, but they really are exactly what we were planning on. Very excited. So the Molossus is an ancient breed. The original Molossus was actually a pack guardian that was used to guard people at the villages, as well as their livestock and animals. So they needed something that was smart enough and bred to protect both animals and people, which is key. And also at the same time, it had to be large enough to defend against multiple people, animals, small bears, wildcats, whatever were around at that time. I'm not exactly the creator of a new breed. I'm simply resurrecting that old ancient breed. And we're talking ancient, 5,000 BC. Very, very old. And all of the mastiff breeds, or what they call the molosser breeds, are from the Molossus, and that's where that term came from. There's actually statues, terracotta statues of this ancient Molossus dog of antiquity, and that's exactly this dog. This is a dream and a passion and a vision that I had. And I'm telling you, I love this ancient Molossus, what it did, what its function was, how it looked. And I dreamt of this. I seen it in my mind. I visualized this. And I'm telling you, I worked extremely hard to make this thing happen. I really, truly believed in this. I wouldn't let anything stop me from doing this. And I'm telling you, in my mind, when I closed my eyes, I saw this dog, how it looked, how it would act. And I worked extremely hard to see that. And it's really crazy because me and my wife were actually in bed and I told her that I can see these dogs, how they look. I can see them walking around my legs, these puppies, the brindle color, the massive body, how they were, how they would act. And it's come to fruition. I've been working on this with my Neapolitan Mastiffs. And obviously, the Neapolitan Mastiff is the closest of all the Mastiff breeds to the ancient Molossus. But it still needed things that were missing. When I got started, I had the vision of what I thought was the perfect Neapolitan Mastiff in temperament and in looks. And so I worked really hard on that. I was very selective of the stock that I used, of how they looked and how they acted. And then once I did the research and realized that I really wanted to go in the direction of the American Molossus, I was the same way. I made a shift and I started being very meticulous about the dogs that I would hand select and keep. One of the really huge differences in the American Molossus from the Neapolitan Mastiff was the thickness of the rear. That is not something that is focused on in the Neapolitan Mastiffs by design. But if you look at the statues and the way those dogs were built, you can clearly see the rears were huge on them, very massive and strong. So that was a point of emphasis. The square head was a point of emphasis. The bone structure is something that's very desired in the Neapolitan Mastiffs, but it's also very desired in the American Molossus because, as you can see in those statues, they had large, massive bones as well. So a lot of the things I used and kept. And then each breeding that I had, I hand-selected to, one, get bigger, thicker rear. And the other thing is the animal aggression. Had to be careful with that because you have to work on their function and temperament. And that is one big difference, is that the Neapolitan Mastiffs or Alphas can be extremely animal aggressive. So you have to watch that when you're selecting as well. So a lot of the work, people will say, well, Marcus, you just crossed. A lot of people do that. A lot of people have done that, and they're exactly right. But it's a lot more than that. It's a lot more in depth. I had to work on this with my own stock first. And then the stuff that I brought in, I didn't just say, well, I'm going to bring in a Presa Canario, for instance, or a Dog de Bordeaux. I had to pick something that had really close to the temperament that I was looking for, that was similar to the Neapolitan Mastiff, but would offset it and give me the size, the health, and the missing components that I needed. And that's why I chose the Old English Mastiff. And it's not just any, because the Mastiffs are a beautiful breed. They have made some changes, but I was very meticulous about the specific type of Old English Mastiff that I used. One, it had to be of a healthy line. It had to have a really large framed body, large bones, large rear, and it had to have that square look, which is really only found in the early Old English Mastiff style dogs. So basically, incorporating those dogs, I had a vision in mind. I was very meticulous about what I wanted people to have and see, and we put these things together over many years, and ultimately we have the litter that we have. Sasquatch, Old World Sasquatch, is the prototype. He is the top two pick from this litter, and he has everything we're looking for. He has the body index, the intelligence, he has the lower drive, he has the really thick rear, the massive thorax, he has everything down to the color of the coat, everything that we're looking for. This was it. But the whole litter was really consistent, and obviously you can see those in the pictures that we have, that the litter came out really good. The form and function was this. They had to be a huge guardian. They had to be able to protect, so they had to be really large. And there's tons of dogs out there, and they're all done for different reasons, you know, the agility and all that stuff. But these dogs simply were close quarter guardians. So they didn't wander. They were very loyal. They were large and massive. The skin, they actually had skin around the neck and on the top of the neck. And that loose skin was to protect them from other animals had they have latched on. The broad, thick rear that they had was ultimately to protect them and to get them to where they could actually handle large animals should they come into battle with them. So everything, every part of it is a part of what went into what they are. And their intimidation factor as well. If there was one or two people that came to a village and they seen these dogs chained up in front, it would ward them off, just the sheer size and look. But obviously the size is also a part of the function of their protection. It starts with the design of the animal and what they were meant to do, and they were bred for that. The looks are always secondary, because the looks are based off what those dogs had to do. So the loose skin, the massive build, the really thick, strong rears, all of those were built into this dog for its function. The way these dogs function today is the same as they would have then. It's already innate in their character. The Molossus breeds that I use for this, they already are guardians. They already protect people. The Neapolitan Mastiffs, which predominantly are what I'm using in this, they already are a pack guardian, close quarter guardian, very similar. The difference between the Neapolitan Mastiff and the American Molossus, probably the clearest difference, is that the Neapolitan Mastiff is an alpha dog and they can be animal aggressive. The American Molossus actually guards and protects animals as well as humans. So that's probably one of the clear differences in their temperament. Well, here's the thing that I would say is that every single dog that we have, they're designers. Whether you would recognize them as a purebred or not, they were all designed by man. And I literally mean that, because if you go back historically, there's only three original dogs. You know, it's the gray wolf, the African wild dog, and the dingo. So everything we have now, from pugs to terrier breeds, and believe me, there's a lot of magnificent dogs that have been designed over the years, and I love them. They're all designed by man. So what I'm doing is nothing new, and I'm not the last either. I'm just excited to bring back something that existed. It functioned correctly for the time, and I think it's historically correct for now. I mean, people have alarms on their homes all the time. They need protection. And there's a lot of people out there that, believe it or not, they love the companionship of dogs. They love to have a dog right by their side, but they want something that they don't have to, that doesn't require going on long runs to get that energy out of them. They want something that's a big, huge companion that they can love, that can be right by their side, and at the same time is gonna protect them if something happens at their home. And believe me, it's needed. So this dog is not just a designer just for looks, but it's designed for function. And I also understand that there's a tremendous amount of breeds out there, and there are people that are in the working breeds that would say, this really isn't a working type breed from what I'm familiar with, and I totally respect that. Dogo Argentinos, Rottweilers, all the different types of dogs, they're all designed by man again, but they all have very unique functions. Some of them are extremely fast, some of them are one-owner dogs, some of them were used for hog hunting. So they all are similar, but all very unique. And this dog here is that same thing. It's very unique. I'm clearly separating it from them because it is not an agile dog that requires running. It will not go and hunt. It wasn't a dog that was used in war where they would run miles and do all those types of things. It was the big beast dog that was left behind to protect. So everything was well thought out. This is not some haphazard thing that I'm gonna breed and just do whatever. I'm trying to tell you that I've thought about this, I've dreamt about this, and I was methodic. Everything is written down from the line breeding on my Neapolitan Mastiffs and the meticulous selection of these Old English Mastiffs that I've used. We have it to where we're at 6 separate breedings. The similarities are on the Old World line. The Old English Mastiffs all have the same thing in common. Although they are not related, they all have the thick, huge, massive structure, the square look, the correct temperament, the correct guardianship traits. All of that was hand selected. So to kind of break it down and be very specific, there'll be 6 breedings that are all F1s, and all of those F1s, all of those breedings will produce the litters, the American Molossus, and all of those will be bred together. And that eliminates the inbreeding, that eliminates the backbreeding, and that eliminates the 3/4. So basically, all of them will be consistent, and at the same time, I'm eliminating any of those problems that you can have with inbreeding, because the health is emphasis. The emphasis has to be on health. So everybody can know what to expect. The size, the look, and all that stuff, but the temperament, and with a focus on health. And that's a big, big deal for me. The American Molossus is a dream of mine. And what I envisioned was bringing back the original Molossus, recreating that dog, and everything is pretty clear. Close quarter guardian, not animal aggressive, a true guardian. Size is gonna be tremendous, and there's a standard already written for that. So the guardianship, the looks, the type, the energy, everything is all designed, all there. And most importantly is health. With a lot of purebreds, I think anybody who's familiar with purebreds, they know that there's a lot of health issues and you want longevity. So the goal with this was to push a 10-year average lifespan. That is the goal for me. And to have something like this that can protect, it can be close quarter, a companion, can guard, look tremendous, be a part of history, look prehistoric, so to speak, and live a long time. I mean, that to me is the ultimate dog. And of course, I'm biased.